genius engineer, a conscious pioneer, a logic general, a reason brigadier. More bullshit from the pulpit. Meet me in the comment section and you get schooled, bitch. The godless engineer.
All right. So, hi, John. Thank you for joining us today. How's your day going so far?
It's going really well. Thank you. It's thank you for asking me to be on the show.
Oh, yeah. So recently on the Friendly Atheist blog, you posted about a beliefless Christianity. I'm wondering if you can, elaborate on that a little bit.
Yeah, well, let me do a backstory behind that, how I got asked to do a guest post for the Friendly Atheist. Hemant Mehta contacted me and asked me to do a guest post because he had heard about me and he thought it was unusual that a Christian might and a Christian minister might have the views that I've had. And it was a few years ago, 2011, I was reading our trade magazine, Presbyterians Today, and the issue came out, What Presbyterians Believe. And it had a list of all of the things and articles about a lot of that. And I read it through and I thought, wow, I don't know if I believe much of any of this. And so I decided to write a post about, well, what really do I believe? What do I think about? And so I wrote down 8 things. I believe in evolutionary theory. I believe that the Bible is a human product, that God is a symbol, that Jesus is a human figure. Most of the stories that we have about him and other sources are legends. I believe that, there's not an end for human beings in the sense of an end time, that the earth will spin long after the last human has breathed his or her last. In other words, I approach things from a natural perspective. And so when he asked me to write this article, I thought, what is my Christianity? It isn't so much about things that I believe, even though I've just used the word belief with you, but it isn't about believing in doctrines. It's more about a practice of living. And so that was kind of the point that I was getting to, is that we use the symbols and the doctrines and the stories of Christianity, not so much as doctrines to believe, but actual things that kind of help us live a life that we want to live or to engage the world, so to speak. And so I was thinking more about belief. I was just thinking in preparation for this interview that we use that word and it means different things the way we use it. I can use it different ways in the same sentence. One way is we think of belief as I believe in evolution. Well, I don't believe in it as a matter of a faith. That's an affirmation of fact. So sometimes we use that word as an affirmation of fact. Sometimes we use the word as, well, I believe there's beer in the fridge. My friends might have drunk it, but I still believe it might be there. All right, we're kind of hoping that it might be there, even though the evidence might look against us. I believe that 9/11 was an inside job. I believe that Sarah Palin would make a great president. Okay, those kinds of things are belief statements. We're not really sure they're true, but we believe them anyway. So sometimes we think of things that way. Then there's a third way, and this is the way I often approach Christianity and my faith tradition, as well as other things. It's like, I believe in you. I don't believe you exist or don't exist, but I trust you. I believe you are a good person to commit my friendship to, or something along those natures. I believe that you're a good guy to have an interview with. That kind of thing. So we use that word believe in a number of different ways. And so sometimes it's rather confusing. And so oftentimes with Christianity, it's been understood as needing to believe doctrines kind of in that first way, as if these are the real things and you have to believe them to be true, or that second part of it that, well, it doesn't look like it's true, but you believe it anyway. And I think we've made Christianity creed-based, that when new evidence comes in, the beliefs are a ceiling and we run into that ceiling. And I think that for many people who are within the Christian tradition, who still like the Christian tradition for a lot of other reasons, that ceiling gets in the way from creative thought. So it was in that spirit that I wrote the column for The Friendly Atheist, that there are those of us who identify as Christian, and I identify as Christian, who wish to see Christianity evolve away from the ceiling of creed to being able to understand it, to use its symbols and whatnot to make life better, to increase human flourishing.
Okay. Well, you know, have you always held this position, or is this something you kind of come into?
This is something certainly I've grown into. I grew up as a child in Southern Baptist and Assembly of God churches, pretty heavy duty, fundamental. And when I was in high school, they didn't make sense. My father was a scientist, and I followed him along, and I learned a great deal from him, as well. My mother was, you know, of the faith, and so I had both of those elements within my life, and I've valued both of them. Actually, I've valued the faith of my mother, and I valued the science of my father, and I always thought somehow these two parts of me ought to be able to find a way to communicate together. But when I was in college, the faith was too small, and I just decided to forget it. And then I ended up marrying into Presbyterianism. My wife was a Presbyterian, and so I followed her into it. And it was a more open tradition. It had, you know, required educated clergy to go to seminaries in which they learned historical criticism of the Bible. They, you know, learned about science and all of these kinds of things. And had, you know, faith be in conversation with that. And so that's the tradition that I come from. And then I began to appreciate really the intellectual aspect of Christianity, and recognize that there's a whole history of people who thought of God and all the different doctrines in different ways than the one that I grew up with. So it has been a process of evolution for me.
Okay. Could you kind of, I guess, explain the what makes Presbyterian, you know, unique to just the general idea of what a Christian is, like just believing in Christ? Like, what's specific about Presbyterianism that sets it apart?
Well, there's a whole history of it that goes back as part of the Reformation movement, but I would say that Presbyterian, for me, has to do with, it's actually really a form of government. Presbyteros is the Greek word, and it means elder, and so it's representative form of government. So the Presbyterian form of government, in which you would elect people to make decisions for you, was pretty revolutionary well back in the 1600s, and in fact became a model for the United States representative government. So in a sense, that's probably the coolest part about it, is that it's a representative democracy. And that means that we aren't static, that we continue to vote on things, and things can change over time. So that's part of it. Now, you might talk to other Presbyterians who would say, no, it's really all about believing in, you know, predestination and all that kind of stuff that, you know, Calvin did in the 16th century. But that isn't where everyone is. And in fact, it's quite a huge umbrella of ways in which people negotiate with the symbols of faith. So, but I would say that a real big part of it has to do with again, approaching higher criticism of the Bible is very much a standard part. Just one quick historical note. I went to Princeton Seminary, and back in the late 1800s, early 1900s, it was really a fundamentalist seminary. In other words, the five fundamentals were part of its whole thing. Inerrancy of the Bible, substitutionary atonement, literal resurrection and miracles of Christ, Christ coming again, these beliefs. And then in the 1920s, it kind of had the big fundamentalist modernist controversy and in the Presbyterian denomination. And the fundamentalists wanted all clergy to sign on. They had to subscribe to these five fundamentals. And well, they didn't win the vote. The modernists won. And they said, you can believe them if you want, but we aren't going to make people subscribe to them. And so then one of the other breakoffs happened in the Presbyterian denomination, and Princeton changed, as well as the other seminaries, and they began to wrestle with higher criticism of the Bible. And so that's really the one that I think gets people more than anything. When you start to look at the Bible as a human product, suddenly all of the magic of it begins to float away, and you are wrestling with what people wrote back then about what they thought back then.
Okay. So I guess that kind of played into you coming to that conclusion that, what God is just that God is just a product of myth making, right?
Yes, God is a huge symbol, and God certainly has evolved throughout all of our traditions. And if there's one thing that's sometimes misunderstood is that we don't we and it's often been taught within certain Christian fundamentalist circles is that God is the exact same all the time, and you go through the Bible and it's all the same. But it isn't. The figure God is different quite a bit. I mean, you look at the second creation story, he's wandering around the garden in the cool of the day. I mean, he's anthropomorphic. And other times he's having a court, holding court in the heavens and doing all this kind of stuff. So God evolved, or the concept of God evolved even within the text itself, and so throughout Christian history. And so, well, human beings obviously made up these stories about and these affirmations about God. And so certainly all aspects of theology are come from the creative human mind. So whether or not there's a reality that they're talking about, well, I don't know. But ultimately, the language certainly itself is from human beings trying to understand things. I'll just give one quick story on this. I think Daniel Dennett, philosopher Daniel Dennett, has a great idea of how we got God in the first place. And that is thinking of pre-modern, thinking of people, we have things happen. And so we give agency to anything that moves. So, for example, your dog, right? So here's a noise. Well, it barks. It thinks there's a who out there, and that's a survival instinct because it could be lunch, or the dog could be its lunch. So automatically, it runs right away to a who. The thinking that somebody did this noise. Well, that's a survival, an evolutionary survival tactic, and the human beings have developed it. The problem with human beings is that we continue to make stories about it. So, especially when there's no one there. And so we've created all kinds of wonderful stories about ghosts and goblins and spooks and the stars being beings itself. And so all of that has come from a supernaturally charged world in which we give agency to anything that moves. And as we've developed along the way, we've recognized that a lot of these things are explained by natural methods, not by divine agents. And that's kind of where we leave ourselves to now. And so God was kind of the big divine agent that kind of set all of this together. And so we've evolved quite a ways. And now the question is, well, what do we mean when we speak about God today? And of course, that was part of my point in the Friendly Atheist was I do not believe in a supernatural being called God that exists outside the universe and interferes with it. And that's been a large part of Christianity, but it's not been the only part, because now many people are redefining what that term means.
Okay, yeah, I would have to totally agree with you. And just a little anecdotal, thing of mine that I usually like to say about ghosts is that, going back to that survival instinct, we have three basic ones, and that's freeze, flee, or fight, in that order. And so, like, whenever you, as a kid, at least I know me, whenever I would think I'd hear a ghost or something walking down the hallway, I would immediately freeze because, ghosts, they can't see you if you freeze. I mean, their eyesight's based on movement, like a T-Rex.
Right. It's the thing of running under the bed when you turn out the lights and you run under the bed and get under the covers, then you can be safe.
Yes, exactly. kind of playing off about God being a myth, how do you feel about Jesus? Do you feel that he was like a historical person, or do you think that he was a myth as well?
Well, there's a lot of wonderful conversation going on about Jesus. The Jesus Seminar, in fact, this goes way back before David Friedrich Strauss, way back in the 1835, wrote a book, Life of Jesus. He lost his career over that book. And it was really a sad story, but it was remarkable. It was pretty obvious. He looked at the stories in the Bible and said, and attributed to Jesus walking on the water or something like that, and saying, you know, that was a mythical story. That was a legend. And so when we look at the stories in the gospel about Jesus, or the other gospels, the other stories about Jesus that were not in, that did not make it into the Bible, it's almost all legend. It's almost all fiction. The Infancy Gospel of Thomas has Jesus as a little kid, you know, turning clay pigeons into real ones, and, you know, a kid bumps into him, so he pushes him off the roof. I mean, all kinds. He's kind of a Dennis the Menace Jesus. Anyway, all those stories are fictional. You look at the gospel stories themselves, the birth narratives, likely legendary. I mean, they contain a lot of mythological symbols, stars moving across the sky, things like that, that you just, that there were obviously, I think, even written with an understanding that these are stories and narratives drawn from other heroes, great births and things like births of great heroes. So you have that. You have the ending stories of resurrection. Those are probably mostly all fiction. Stories of, like I say, walking on the water. Those are, you know, motifs in which the hero becomes that. Now, once you start to do the work of demythologizing and try to strip away, well, was there a person behind that that they wrote these stories about? And there's great debate on that. Robert Price, for example, would say, no, that Jesus is a mythical figure. Others, Dominic Crossan, say, no, that he was an historical person, but, you know, a lot of legends and parables were told about him. So there's a great debate between that. I don't know exactly. I tend to think that there probably was a guy. I think he probably was a social prophet and a wisdom teacher, and people believed after he had died that his whatever it was, his vision was popular to them, and so they had visions of him and carried on his movement. So in a sense, he lives in the movement that followed after him.
Okay. me, myself, I'm what you would call a mythicist. I think that, you know, he was a myth. But, I mean, that's just from what I have read and kind of investigated for myself. And, I mean, I'm not the kind of person that's going to sit here and be like, no, you have to believe what I believe, kind of thing, you know. So,
lots of problems in the world, which is one of the reasons I was going for beliefless Christianity, is that look at all the violence that's done with people saying, I believe this and you do too, or you should too. But anyway, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Yeah, so you understand that Jesus is mythical from top to bottom.
Well, yeah, at least that's what the conclusion that I've come to. And, you know, that's just from me trying to be as non-biased as I can about the evidence. And, and so that's just kind of what I've come to. And like I said, I'm not all about pushing, you know, you have to believe what I believe, kind of thing. And I know that a lot of atheists out there kind of get a rap for being that kind of atheist, but, I know you're not worried about me telling you have to believe in the myth, kind of deal, but, you're not ready to let go of the idea of a God. Why is that?
Well, for probably the big reason is that God, the symbol itself, is a powerful symbol, and it has a long track record, and there are, and it has an emotional connection with many people, and I think it just takes a while for us to wrestle with this. I think for first making that step that, you know, that we're not, when we speak of God, that I'm not speaking of a supernatural being out there that interferes, that God might be a metaphor for Paul Tillich. Here's the big theologian of the 20th century. He said, if you think that God is something to believe in or not believe in, you're not thinking of God. For him, he understood that God is being itself. That was the word he used a lot, being, existence, whatever reality is. God was, in the Western world, the symbol for that. And so that's a far cry from the old guy in the sky who comes and intervenes and does all kinds of things. So there's a lot of space for thinkers to be able to redefine what the term means. Now, some, including some of my colleagues, Greta Vosper, I'm thinking of the United Church of Canada, has decided that she's a minister in a church, but she's moved beyond using the word at all. She thinks it's too confusing. So she doesn't want to use the symbol God at all. There are some who will say, no, it's good to redefine it. I'm generally in the term, I don't know. I'm redefining it now. I just think it's good to be honest about what all the possibilities are. I do think that the word God has a lot of cultural power to it, and people do a lot of things in God's name. And a lot of those things aren't so good. So I think if maybe we can define or understand God in a little broader way, or add even some confusion to it, to people's certainty, that might hopefully make people think twice about, you know, doing all kinds of bad things in the name of God. So in other words, God has a lot of baggage, and we might redefine it. So for me, I can think of in terms of that God is a commitment to a way of living, and it's a particular kind of God. It's the name we give to this ultimate reality, and so that's why I consider myself a Christian, because whether Jesus was a myth or whether Jesus was historical or not, there's something that is powerful about his story to me, that is the story of standing on the side of the marginalized, on the oppressed, a teacher of wisdom, taking on the powers that be. So there's a sense in which that commitment to that kind of vision is a way of saying that's my commitment to what God is. I know that sounds kind of vague and confusing and messy, and I'm okay with that. It just, you know, I think that there we're in a time of transition as a whole culture, in which a lot of these symbols that we've taken from the pre-modern era are really having a lot of mixing up, and who knows what's going to happen out of that. But I think simply being honest with it and naming the problem is a start.
I would have to agree. And would you consider then that you use God as more of a metaphor?
Yes, I would say God certainly is a metaphor. And a metaphor for what, we might say? A metaphor for many different things, depending on how people use it. I suppose if you were to poll people in the congregations I've served what God is, you'd probably find, you know, 1,000 different answers. Maybe people would have more than one. People might have one day and another day. So it's a term that just absorbs a great deal. And so yes, I think it certainly is a metaphor. What that metaphor is for certainly would require a great deal of conversation and talking about it for a long time, I think, which would be a good thing.
Yeah, and me personally, I don't think any like good idea or whatnot just immediately is like, you know, comes into existence. I think it takes time to build up an idea that's really solid. So, I mean, I'm really glad that you're taking that approach to your faith and whatnot. So what would you say to a person that is kind of questioning their belief in a supernatural God?
I would encourage them to go on and question. I think that's the best way to grow, is to question what you've been taught. You know, part of a lot of my ministry has been to people who've grown up in a church that was really heavy duty and said, this is what you need to believe. And if you don't believe this, you're going to hell, and all of that kind of stuff. And they've got, and man, I don't believe in that God, and I think that, and I don't think they would have to either. And if they're starting to question that, then absolutely question that. So a lot of Christianity has been pretty negative, and not all of it by any means, but a lot of it has. And so I think helping people come out of the negative aspects of it, and I think when once people, and it isn't hard, really. I mean, when you think about it, someone quipped that Galileo put God out of a home, all right, and Darwin put God out of a job. In other words, he no longer is he in the heavens. You think of the the ancient Near Eastern understanding of the cosmos is like one of those little bowls that you shake, you know, those little towns in the ball. And there is the dome up above, and that was the sky, and the stars were all in it in this firmament. And that first creation story of separating the waters from the waters was doing that, making that little bowl. And the gods all populated up in there. And then down below was Sheol. And the big worry was that the water would come up from the bottom and the top. And that's the whole flood story that kind of filled up the little bowl. That was their understanding of it. It isn't that they were dumb. That's just how they, when they looked out there before they had telescopes, before they had an understanding of how the universe worked, that's how it fit. By the time Jesus comes around, Ptolemy's understanding of the universe. You have the earth in the center, and you have the sun and the moon and the various planets, the heavens, the spheres of the heavens rotating around it. And so you could imagine God still kind of hanging up there. He's got a spot, and Jesus rises up to join him. And all kinds of gods coming up and down. Caesar was understood to be a god. After he would die, then he would go up and join the pantheon of all the other gods and whatnot. That was the whole muse of the whole system of supernaturalism and the understanding of the universe. It isn't until we get all the way past Columbus's time, well into the 1500s, that Galileo and Copernicus start to say, wait a second, they're looking out there. And now, you know, my dad's 96. He was born in 1918. And when he was born, the understanding of the universe was that the Milky Way galaxy was the universe. The next year, Hubble looked out into his telescope, and he recognized that those little blobs were not little blobs that were stars within the galaxy, but they were actual other galaxies. And so how incredible is that? That's the universe we live in now. Hubble telescope, not the one he looked for, the one that was named for him, now taking images 10 to 15 billion light years away. That's the universe we live now. All right. So all of our symbols have to be reinterpreted. And if they don't survive, they should be thrown out. But we don't know exactly what's going to be reinterpreted and what's going to last and what isn't. And so we're kind of in that mix right now. But I think, again, the idea is to simply be open to what this amazing, beautiful, fantastic universe is, and then how we understand our place in it.
Okay. There are a lot of apologists out there that would argue that the Bible had it right in the beginning and science had it wrong, and then it eventually got right, as in to suggest that science caught up with the Bible. I mean, what would you say to somebody that was kind of, you know, putting that out there, that the Bible has got it right because they read it in a certain way and interpret it in a certain way that makes it align with, you know, what science says?
Yeah. I like to tell the story of Christopher Columbus, and he's a great figure because the reason why Columbus sailed to sailed the ocean blue in 1492 is he was trying to get to China, and he wanted to get to China because he wanted to get gold, and he wanted to get gold so he could fund a crusade so he could take back Jerusalem from the Muslims so that Christ would come again. That's often not a story we don't know about. That Carol Delaney, Columbus and the Quest for Jerusalem, is a great book. And so why is he like that? Well, he's a product of his time. He was a smart guy. He was, you know, but he lived in the late 1400s. And he understood that his whole universe was contained in the narrative of the Bible, from the creation to revelation. And he even went and calculated on his own the date of creation. I don't know exactly what it was, but probably around 6,000 BC. Bishop Usher, a century later, dated it to 4004 BC at 9 in the morning. All right, that's when creation started. So Columbus does the same thing. He dates it. And then he even dates calculating things to when the end is going to come, about 150 years after him. So he figures he's part of this big movement to bring Jesus back and start the whole thing. So he wants to get this crusade going. But here's the funny part. He thought that it was going to be an easy trip over to China. He knew the world was a globe, but he knew how far it was to get on land from Europe to China. But in the Bible, there's a verse in 2 Esdras that talks about how God fashioned earth six parts land and one part water. And so he thought, well, that's true. It's in the Bible. So he thought it would be an easy, quick trip by boat to get to China the other way. And of course, well, he ended up running into, you know, later became North and South and Central America. And even then, he's driving, he's boating around there, and he's thinking he's getting close to the Garden of Eden. I tell this whole story because that's Columbus's world, the medieval world. And the world was understood as contained within the narrative of the Bible. Now we recognize and we look at the Bible and we see it's a human product that came, you know, finished itself probably between 3000 and 2000 BC. There are all kinds of books. There are books that are older than that. And stories and various cultures. So we recognize now that it's a human product. And so I think that change has been not appreciated by a lot of people, and I would say a lot of it is because the creed gets in the way. All this stuff that we're supposed to believe actually stops us from thinking, and it stops our creativity, and it requires people, I think, within the tradition itself to say, no, this doesn't count anymore. You can't go to superstition to simply say your Bible came out from the sky and it's somehow magical and has all the truths in it. That doesn't work. You're going to have the Bible. If it's going to have authority for you, it's going to have to be able to stand up to the court of reason.
Yeah, I think that's a very good example. I think it's a very good example of how Christianity has really changed over time as well. Because, you know, there's that idea that's really being pushed hard right now by some Christians and apologists that you know, the Bible hasn't changed and that science has changed. Therefore, you want to stick with the thing that hasn't. It's been right all the time.
Is it? I mean, you want to believe the same thing you believed when you were six? I mean, you want to be able to, one would think that you'd want to change your mind as new evidence comes to you. But go ahead.
Yeah. And so I really appreciate you sharing that bit of information about Columbus, because I think that is just one of the best examples I've heard to present to somebody is like, well, you know, they understood it as this. And I know that some people are going to come back with, well, they had just interpreted it wrong. But I mean, when you get to that point of the conversation where they're basically moving the goalpost as far as the translation of the Bible, I think the fact that God's inerrant word has a translation issue is a kind of a big problem.
It's really unfortunate that fundamentalist Christianity has become the voice and face of Christianity. And it wasn't always like that. Like I say, you know, fundamentalism is actually fairly new, about 120 years old. It was in response to Charles Darwin and in response to higher criticism of the Bible that these folks came in and said, no, they're all panicky and said, no, you have to believe these fundamental things. And then it got popular back in the late 70s and 80s. Mega churches, everything going, everything is that way. Books, publishing houses, television, radio. I live in Portland, the most liberal city in the country, and all the Christian radio stations are fundamentalist. I mean, there's just not any other voice out there. And so it ends up having silly arguments like the one you have, and it ends up pitting people against each other, have no reason, you know, like, for example, people responding against that, atheists or whatever, but there's a lot of middle ground of people who I think are, you know, are more thoughtful about all of these items, and so it ends up being silly arguments rather than fruitful ones, in my view.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. And just to kind of illustrate, you know, how silly these arguments get, I don't know if you're familiar with Answers in Genesis.
I know good old Ken Ham. He wrote a blog post about me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to have to check that out after the interview. But they're pushing this idea, and make sure I can get this right. It's anisotropic syncope convention. And I don't expect you to know what that is. But in short, what it is they're saying that light... And I only bring this up because you were talking about Hubble and you know, and everything. that light travels infinitely fast from its origin point and then infinitely slow on the way back, so that it averages out to be the speed of light. But that's how they explain, you know, how light can get to the Earth from, you know, so far away, You know, because, you know, there's that whole starlight problem with the creation story, like, you know, because, you know, they are, you know, millions of light years away, and they needed a way to explain it. And that is the length that they go to in order to explain, you know, stuff like that. And
has this been peer reviewed?
It's one scientist. I don't think he's been peer reviewed, but in the little interview that AIG put out, he was like, that's an interesting possibility. It's like, okay, that is an interesting hypothesis. That doesn't mean that it's, I guess it is necessarily possible, but that doesn't mean that it's probable. And they're like picking holes in science and being like, aha, here's a hole. And which is basically God of the gaps. You know, here's a hole, and you know, we're gonna insert our own ideology in there and totally, you know, checkmate atheists.
that kind of nonsense is a disservice to just intelligence. It makes human beings collectively dumber. That there is it ruins. Basically, that was one of the big things I worked about mostly in my last church, was this anti-evolution stuff, that people were constantly pushing kind of creationist kind of stuff in public school curriculum and all of that kind of thing. And so we were trying really hard to end that and to have Christian ministers to come out and say that's silly. We affirm evolution, affirm science. Science should be taught in school if you want to teach whatever it is you want to call it. You can save that for your church. I wish they wouldn't even teach it there, because I think it makes their kids, well, we'll eventually get them, hopefully, when they go to school and we can talk about these things. But I really think it does. It's a really desperate attempt to hold on to a view of religion that never even was. It's a modern warping of Christianity. It wanted to stop all process and to stop any progress, and then say this is what it is. And I think it's laughable if it wasn't so harmful.
I couldn't agree more. I mean, I think that it is pretty harmful, and the way that people kind of, because I think it's good that they question and they want to learn answers, but or figure out answers. But it's like they are presented with the answers, but then because it doesn't align with the Bible, they just chuck that answer. And I think that, go ahead.
Well, Ken Ham, right, he came, we used to do at my previous congregation, Evolution Sunday. So near Darwin's birthday, we would celebrate evolution. And we'd have teachers and come in and talk about different things. And we connected with the Natural History Museum where we were. And in response to that, about 100 congregations, this is in East Tennessee, needed to kind of have a counter to that or whatever. And so they invited Ken Ham and that crew to come down for Darwin's birthday and do a bunch of lectures and stuff. And it was, and he had in the Freedom Hall, which is kind of one of the, you know, basic where the basketball plays and stuff. He must have had 4,000 people on a school day. I guess they didn't even go to school, but they came to hear him talk. And so he's talking to the little kids, and he's saying stuff like this, and having them repeat back. I got this on a video that he had made. He said, "All right, children, did any animals die before Adam and Eve sinned?" And then they all go, "No." It's like, how weird is that? And yet that's the kind of indoctrination that's being taught to children all of the time. And no wonder people want to just say Christianity, you should just shut the churches down, just close them all. I mean, I get that. And so I want to say, no, that there's just another way to look at it. And we have to speak up about it.
Yeah. I have to say that if I was in that particular, as a kid, if I was in there, I know that I would have to take a second. I wouldn't answer immediately. I was like, wait, what a second. Did animals die before Adam and Eve sinned? What?
Yeah, of course, we want to complain that the whole myth of Adam and Eve, you know, that they brought death into the world before them. There was no death and all that stuff. So it's taking a story that was obviously written to be mythical and then making it literal.
Yeah, and I really, like, even as a kid, I didn't regard those things as, like, historical deals. You know, like... I always found myself forcing myself to believe in certain things, and so, you know, that's kind of what I struggled with as I was coming out of, like, you know, structured religion and into more of a questioning phase.
Right.
But now, getting back on track, okay. Recently you had some problems with some protesters. I'm wondering if you could elaborate on that a little bit.
Yeah, at my congregation that I currently serve in Beaverton, Oregon, Southminster Presbyterian Church, this congregation was instrumental in helping our denomination move toward redefining its constitution to include marriage between two people as opposed to a man and a woman. And that just happened in 2014. And actually, the vote of the final presbytery happened on St. Patrick's Day of this year, that the 86th Presbytery voted yes, and so that put the new amendment into our constitution. So now marriage is defined as between two people. Traditionally, a man and a woman is the phrase, but instead of just a man and a woman. All right. Well, part of my congregation was among many, helped to get that thing going and passed. That we sent an overture up to the presbytery, and that went and made it happen. And so there was news articles about that. And well, at the same time, the same day that vote happened, my article appeared in the Friendly Atheist about beliefless Christianity, which it was titled, "I'm a Presbyterian Minister Who Doesn't Believe in God," which was, well, yes, that's true. I don't believe in a supernatural being. I mean, we can talk about what God is, but I got it. I got the whole point of what was going on with that. So that came out, and then this article came out, and then the Christian news picked it up and went kind of crazy with it. And, you know, I'm a false teacher and all of this kind of stuff. And there was a whole bunch of, and it just went all over. I was just kind of searched the internet a little bit, and all the Christian radio stations had picked up the story. Jim Baker, you know, Jim Baker TV, and all of this kind of stuff. And so they're all going at this. And so I obviously had touched a nerve with this article. And I think some of these, it's hard to call them protesters. They were mostly just guys holding ugly signs and yelling obscenities and Jesus, which is kind of an interesting combination. But anyway, so there are just four of them, and they were mostly just saying a lot of anti-gay stuff and a lot of, you know, your minister doesn't believe in God and all of this kind of stuff. And most of our people were just kind of shrugged, you know, and they were really annoying. And they were here for one Sunday, and hopefully that's the end of them. But that was part of that show. But that shows that they're that real fear aspect of Christianity when it gets of some Christians when they get challenged on things. And I think that fear touches something, because I think that deep down, people know that the stuff that they're supposed to believe, there's something wrong with it. That somewhere along the way that it doesn't quite match, but they're supposed to, and they have to, and they have to really work hard to keep, you know, all those doubts in check. And anybody who brings them up is messing with it, because they work so hard keeping all those doubts down. And then someone who, like a minister, who says, doubt away, and that really makes them mad because they've put a lot of energy into that. And so, and I think that's a lot of what's happening in regards to the response to my column.
Yeah. Did you get any of the Psalm 14:1, like only a fool, says that there's no God and whatnot? Did you get any of that? Like them throwing scripture at you, like you don't know it.
I get emails all the time. I got an email today from someone who quoted a whole list of scripture, you know, telling me I need to be born again. I'm Satan and I'm a false teacher. And there you go.
Yeah,
it's part of the deal. I think that's I put it, you know, I put it again as, all right, obviously I've touched a nerve, and that nerve needs to be touched, and we need to poke that and let people begin to think for themselves. And because of Christianity, if you're going to have it at all, and it's something you have to believe in, then what's the point of it? I mean, it should be something that you would want to believe in, you know, or not, or but rather than to be forced into all these kinds of beliefs, I think is really damaging to the psyche, and ultimately, I think it's not good for our society either. We can see what happens all over the world when zealotry gets a hold of populations, and it was actually kind of scary, really, to get the volume of response. That level of just raw anger was a little frightening.
Yeah. Can you kind of give us like just off the top of your head, like what kind of comments have you received because of your Pathyost blog post and just all of your activism in general? Like I know that you said that you had the one email today that basically called you Satan for some reason, and but have there been more extreme like comments or whatnot, or more hateful, or?
Well, most of them are along the line that I can't be a Christian. That's probably what made most people angry, is that I identify as a Christian, and they say, no, you're not. You're not a Christian. You're a false teacher. You don't believe in all these things, and so. A lot of them are along those lines, that they couldn't reconcile the fact that I might have an understanding of the natural world as I do, and yet at the same time value the Christian structure and the Christian teachings. That's what really angered them, and so they all felt that I should, you know, be eliminated from my position. That a lot of character assassination. That I'm only in it for the money, and you know, a lot of name calling, a lot of stuff like that. And but again, I'm kind of used to it. I've been out here doing this kind of stuff for a long time because I think it's important, and I'm not the only one. I think of, I don't know if you've heard of Bishop John Shelby Spong in the Episcopal Church. He wrote a great book in the 90s called Why Christianity Must Change or Die. And he was arguing the same kinds of things. And so there are many people who are saying that stuff and get the price, you know, get hit by Christian fundamentalists for it. And that's what happens.
Yeah. Crap, I had kind of a side question, but can you kind of elaborate a little bit on what you exactly preach with your congregation? What your sermons are generally promote?
Okay, well, this Sunday was Easter. All right, so the Easter story is about resurrection. And so I talked about, and often I have to start with naming the cognitive dissonance that many people feel when they come to church and they need to hear the story of Jesus rising from the tomb, and they simply doesn't make sense to them in a literal way. So you have to understand, and I don't think it ever was meant to be that. I think it was always good. There are the scandal of Christianity. I often talk about what was the real scandal that Jesus produced. And it wasn't, and he was called Son of God. All right. That was one of the things, Son of God. Well, the scandal wasn't that he was Son of God, that he was some kind of supernatural being, because there were all kinds of sons of God. Caesar was considered a son of God. So in fact, one of the criticisms of Christianity by like 100 years after his time about the Christians was that, what's so special about Jesus? We got all kinds of stories like that too. And I think the real scandal of Jesus, for example, was the scandal of his political activism, is that he was as Dominic Crossan, the historical Jesus scholar, said, a peasant with an attitude. He was on the side of the marginalized. He was crucified, executed by Rome's, boom, peace. Their peace through victory and violence. And he was an advocate, as I understand the historical person, he was an advocate of justice, of community making, of, you know, basically overthrowing, I think nonviolently, but overthrowing oppressive systems. And so he was executed, you know, and the sign all put in his thing that he, king of the Jews, we can't have any king besides, you know, Caesar. So there is a seditious element to him. So in other words, the Son of God, who are you going to vote for? It was kind of like, do you want Caesar, that Son of God, or Jesus? It was what he stood for. And so what I think of the resurrection is not so much the rising of bodies. It was really his followers didn't lie down and die. They didn't just give up when their leader was executed. They formed a movement to continue in the things that he talked about. And I think that aspect is what resurrection may mean for us today. It's, you know, whenever it's not from death to life, it's from brokenness to life, brokenness, individuals, brokenness of society itself. It's the hope that truth crushed will rise again. And those are the kinds of things I preach, I guess. It would be, you know, understanding these messages in an existential way, in a transformative way, rather than in a miraculous kind of supernatural way.
Okay. In your Pathos blog post, you actually mentioned that at one woman's commitment statement, basically, she admitted a lot of social justice commitments, but, you know, she also admitted that she didn't believe in a literal supernatural God. Is that pretty common for your congregation, or are you a pretty diverse group?
Yeah, that would have been my previous congregation. And it was a confirmation class, so meaning the young woman is young high school age. All right, so and one of our things of the tradition is that when they join the church, they go through a confirmation class and they give their statements of faith. I really think that everybody should do it, whether they're not just high school students, because I think it would be really interesting if you were actually honest about the stuff you really believed in. And so when I did the class with them, I just encouraged them to, as they always would do, think for themselves. And these were her thoughts, and they were great. And so I would say, yeah, she probably was a little bit unusual. I don't think I've ever had anybody quite so forward and say it like that. But nevertheless, it was an honest conviction, and she wanted to be I want to be part of the community. And here's what I think about things. And people said, okay. And I think it actually probably touched. Was meaningful for a lot of people, because I think many people think the same thing, but they didn't think they can say it. So I have a lot of people who will probably say, yeah, I don't know if I believe all that, who now do, certainly when they get to know me, they'll say, yeah, I don't think I believe all this stuff either. But it's okay that I do that, right? And I go, yeah, it's okay. It's okay. In fact, I don't care what you believe in the end of the day. I'm not here to tell you to believe it or not believe it, but I am going to present information and you can go with it. And some of that information might be disturbing. It might, you know, kind of shake things up a little bit for you. And I'm still on your side. I'm with you, but that's okay. You can go through it and have these kinds of thoughts and come out the other end and think differently than me. And that's okay too. And so I think that was a great credit to the diversity of our congregation to recognize that, yeah, people are on different paths and we're going to celebrate wherever they are.
Yeah, I would say that's a very good way of building a community and really providing a support group, basically, for each sure. other, because you know, that's what a community is. I mean, me, that's what I'm trying to do right now is build a community right. for atheists and and trying to provide a place where they can come and get advice or whatnot, and so I really commend you for providing that kind of space for people to not feel so constrained. By a faith or anything like that. I think, you know, speaking from a mental health aspect, I think that is really providing a very good, you know, positive reinforcement of having your own beliefs and not being, you know, judged or cast aside because you believe differently.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you. Good for you and your community. I think that's great.
Yeah, well, you know, with atheists, you know, I don't know if it's more diverse or whatnot, but we've run into the problem of people not being able to basically act like adults, and so we've had to become a little bit more exclusive as far as our behavior within our group goes. But I mean, that's going to happen with just about any group,
right?
But you know, kind of going back to what we were talking about with Ken Ham, I'm kind of curious how you feel about childhood indoctrination. There's been a lot of talk about it being, akin to child abuse. And along those lines, there's actually been studies done that have suggested that kids that have been indoctrinated into some kind of religious faith have a tougher time in discerning fact from fiction. I'm wondering, can you give me your thoughts on childhood indoctrination in that context?
Yeah, that I think that's a very I think you bring up a very good point. I think we have to be careful how we use the word abuse, because that can be I think that's for something particular, pretty specific to emotional abuse, physical abuse, all of those kinds of things. I even use the word spiritual abuse, and how we understand that. I grew up in a fundamentalist church. I don't think it was abusive, but I think I had to do a lot of work coming out of it. Fortunately, I didn't have, I had parents who were open-minded and who encouraged me to think for myself. So that's quite a bit different from many families who are not, or who understand that they, that they're somehow required to do that. And so we find, I think, abusive situations in terms of children denied medical care or those kinds of things because they don't, because of religious beliefs and those kinds and that aspect. But I would call it, that indoctrination problematic. And I think we have to trust children to be, to be smarter than that, that they can here are some varied views and make your own choices. And I think that's the best way to educate our children. And whether it's in a religious setting or not, I think they're more likely to have a positive view of the religious setting if it were a place in which they allowed for freedom of thought, rather than one that was, pushed down on them.
Yeah, I guess along the same lines as you, I feel that it can be abusive, but I don't think that necessarily any kind of bringing up a child in religion is abuse. Just to stress, I think that it can be used abusively, which I think is what you were saying, and I don't support that, but. Those that implement their faith in a very non-abusive way, I have no problems with those type of people. Now, me as an atheist, I guess I wish that they would, not really bring religion into like the whole child rearing aspect of it. But at the same time, I'm a parent myself. I don't want people telling me how to parent my child. So, I'm not gonna tell people how to parent their child. But, that doesn't restrict me from calling out abuse when it's clearly abuse.
Yeah. Well, I think, we have children in our church and we encourage them to come and they can learn all kinds of different things. Sometimes we learn, the tradition, the cultural traditions of the Bible, of spirituality, of whatever it is. And I think that's a real healthy thing. And some of them grow up and continue on, and some of them, have liked it and moved on to different places. And I think, it's not so much the curriculum as how it's presented, and certainly our different faith traditions are from a wide variety of faith traditions. Right across the street from us is the Islamic Center of Portland. I mean, so there's a faith traditions there too. And so I think that milieu of being involved with all kinds of people from different faith traditions that we can learn about, different cultures, I think are all good, as well as cultures of skeptics. In fact, one of our statements, we're a progressive Christian, and one of the, we welcome all people, whether they're conventional Christians or skeptics or agnostics or traditional believers or whatever. So, it's all in the mix, of people being able to come and to question and to be in community together and to, try to make the world a better place and not pick on people so much.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with that. So to kind of round off the interview here, what are you doing for 2015? Do you have any like big plans that you're planning on doing either for your congregation or for activism in general?
Well, when we're excited, we're still kind of celebrating our work with sexual and gender minorities and the marriage amendment, and being a congregation that is known in the area for fully welcome and equality on those types of issues. I think one of the issues that we face with in Portland is a big one is homelessness, and I know that that our congregation is working on ways in which we can talk about homelessness, even in the town that we live in is kind of a suburb. Beaverton really has a lot of homeless youth, and how can we as a congregation better work in those areas? One of the things I'm working on right now is getting my radio program going again. I've had it for 3 years, Religion for Life, and talking about all kinds of different ways. I've interviewed everyone from atheists to different kinds of scholars to religious scholars to people who are activists in their various traditions. And so I'm getting that going. I'm hopefully get that going within a couple of weeks. So, but other than that, I'm also new to my congregation. So I'm doing a lot of kind of congregational work and getting to know people and figuring out where we want to go as a congregation and what issues we want to take on next.
Okay, that sounds really awesome. I know, the homelessness has kind of been a sort of a topic here recently, just in general. So yeah, I think that's an awesome thing to take up. If you had to say one thing to the atheists out there that might be, thinking that you're not a Christian and blah, 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 what would you say to them?
Well, I think you ought to let people define themselves or how they want to be defined. People were often saying, well, you can't be a Christian and you can't be an atheist at the same time. Well, I don't necessarily identify as an atheist, probably philosophically, we're quite similar on many things, but there's a connotation to the term. Every term has a political baggage to it. And for example, I'm not against, I like church. And so I just think that we ought to take critical thinking and bring it into church. So I don't know what that makes me. I mean, I feel that, yeah, I'm a Christian. I'm on the team. I like the stories of Jesus, even if he was a totally mythical character. Well, still, I think that there's aspects of that that's still great to work on. And so I think that we put a lot of focus on labels. And I think most human beings are a lot more mixed up than that. And I think that being mixed up is okay. And it's fluid, however we define ourselves in our own life, in our own life journey, rather than have to stick to something and say, I'm this and I'm not that. I don't know. I'm a lot of things. And Christian is one of them. And my atheist friends and buddies, and I want to say that atheists are some of the most discriminated group against in the country. And so there's a sense in which I identify as an atheist just for solidarity, because I think that that everybody ought to be able to be to have freedom and to have equal rights and to be treated with respect, regardless of what they believe or don't believe.
Yeah, I agree. And I have to say, out of all the religious groups in America right now, I would say that your type of thinking I completely support. And I know that there's a growing movement to become this beliefless Christianity. I believe you even mentioned that in your Pathos blog post. But I think that that type of Christianity is really moving to the forefront, and the fundamentalism really just kind of hangs on the edge and on the fringes of what we think of as Christianity. And the only reason why they get highlighted in the news and are really seen as some kind of voice for Christianity is the fact that the news it wants to focus on them because they say outrageous things.
I think you're right. I think a lot of that bluster is the last gasp. I hope. I could say that and be totally wrong, but I mean, I'm kind of hope that that last big push of meanness really and narrowness is a last one, and I think people are hopefully finding new ways to understand whatever it is they are as human beings, whatever cultural traditions they grab onto.
Okay, well, John, I really appreciate you joining me today for this interview, and I can't wait to hear your radio broadcast. Is it going to be available like as a podcast or online anywhere?
Yeah, it is podcast right now. It's religionforlife.com, and you can go to the website and you can hear podcasts. And you can, the whole 3 years worth, 144 of them are on right now. And it's on 3 radio stations right now. And I'm running reruns, and I'm going to start some new ones actually within 2 or 3 weeks. Hopefully by the 1st of May, I'll get some new shows going, produced here in Portland. And so, but yeah, people can listen to it on podcast, and then I'm hopefully get it on a local station or two, which would be good too.
Okay. Awesome. Well, again, thank you for joining me, and I hope you have a nice rest of the day.
All right. Thank you. I enjoyed it a lot.